Good evening to everybody, and thank you for coming out in the rain. The title, as you heard tonight, that I chose for the lecture was The New Culture of Frederick Douglass and Bob Marley, Beyond Racialism. So I'm kind of trying to think about a big issue here, and that's basically how do we build what Nelson Mandela called a multiracial or a non-racial democracy? And the basic challenge I set for myself in the book was to think about new forms of identity and of community in which commonality and difference can coexist. It seems to me that that's really the challenge that we face, especially here in a state like California, where we already have a minority majority. So I'm looking at models of identity and community in my book on racial frontiers of Frederick Douglass, Ralph Ellison, and Bob Marley, models of people who were trying to build a language that goes beyond race. So the challenge I see in terms of coming to know what diversity means, as Troy Duster once said over at UC Berkeley, is, as I said, to build new forms of identity and of community and of citizenship. And basically what I'm arguing that this is going to require us to go through individual and collective transformations, and in particular that we need to move beyond binary racialized models of identity, of community, and towards the formation of new cultures, cultures that are capable both of fighting against injustice, but also cultures which are capable of reclaiming or affirming that which is valuable in our heritage. So I think a lot of times now in public discourse that commonality and difference are seen as opposing concepts. And I see this as an action-reaction cycle. It's a historically necessary corrective that we once excluded a lot of histories, and now we're often celebrating difference for its own sake. So the people that I studied in my book, Marley and Ellison and Douglass, were all involved in the same processes of trying to overcome exclusions and to voice identity, but also to build a vision that was capable of maintaining commonality and difference. Now, it just so happens that the three main figures of my book are what we're accustomed to call black. So I'm going to sort of bite the hand that feed me here during Black History Month and focus on these people, particularly Douglass and Marley, as icons that should force us to re-examine our habit of putting people and cultures into racialized boxes as a way of getting at this question of how do commonality and difference exist in a diverse society. I argue that Douglass and Ellison and Marley were not just black. That to see them as such, in fact, to ghettoize them and to confine them within a black box is to perpetuate a form of mental slavery to which they themselves were opposed. So blackness was an important part of their identity and of their community, but at the same time, all of these men saw themselves as representative of a new culture that could not be defined by merely racial terms. Now, this seems like a paradox in some ways, but I think that it's really only a paradox because we've been blinded in many ways by racial mythologies, and we view the past through racial mythologies. Figures like Douglass and Marley point to an alternative to these binary models, to a non-racial democracy, as Nelson Mandela said, to a beloved community, as Martin Luther King was fond of saying, or in the words of Bob Marley, simply Rasta. And we'll talk about that one later on. Now, the community in which they lived and to which they spoke was clearly rooted in what we are accustomed to call black culture and black history. And to be sure, the fight against racial injustice was central to all of their lives. Yet Douglass and Marley in particular made very explicit claims to be part of a community that went beyond race. So let me tell you just a little bit about some of the commonalities of the people in my book, because this is the first thing people usually ask me is, What do these guys have in common? And I began answering that in the preface. They had several commonalities. They were all of mixed heritage, biologically and culturally. In the case of Douglas and Marley in particular, they're biracial, born to white fathers and black mothers. They talk about this a lot, and it's central to who they are and the kinds of communication that they engage in. They all were enormously successful in using a communication form of their day, journalism, literature, and music, to speak to a vast audience that was multiracial and multinational. They also, as it turns out, all grew up without their fathers. None of them had a father around to guide them as they were forming the identity. And I think this is an important reason why all of them looked to more distant horizons to imagine new forms of identity and culture. And they were all accused in their time of, because that they spoke to mixed audiences and didn't define themselves as just black, they were all accused of being a sellout or insufficiently radical and such. So they had similar responses to that. I'll leave that to those who you want to hear about it from my book, but they had very interesting responses about the notion of what, as Marley said, was a true revolutionary. So in the book I write that all were inheritors of and co-creators of a new culture that was often racialized in its origins, and yet it spoke to a multi-ethnic and a multinational audience, to audiences of the present and of the future for whom racial language would be inadequate. Now, another thing they all had in common that was that Douglas and Ellison and Marley all believed that the problems of racism couldn't be solved with the language of race. So their really deepest critique was of racialism, which is, as Ellison said, the insidious confusion between race and culture which haunts our society. That's absolutely central to what all of them did, to try to make this distinction between culture, which is something that we learn, and race. We confuse the two. Race, of course, is about genetics, about phenotype. I'll talk to you about that in a moment. But the main idea that they had regarding racialism, this confusion of race and culture, that's a problem that all of us perpetuate. So Ellison made many examples of that. I'll just give you something really brief, which is that if you raise, let's say, a black youth in Japan, what do you get? Most probably, you get a culturally Japanese youth. And we need to realize that, I think. So I'm going to give you a preview sort of where I'm coming from. I have to face these issues in my own life. I've got two children who were born to an Afro-American mother and me who's of Irish ancestry. And I only speak Spanish with my children. So what box do they fit in? And the argument that the people in my book made is that far from being something outside the norm, people like my children are actually the norm in American society in many ways, that it's been racial mythologies. That's why we say that race is socially constructed, right? That the line between black and white or between groups is always arbitrary. It's a socially constructed line. So central to my book is an effort to engage in this critique of the notion of race and to think of alternatives at the same time as that I'm very historically grounded in and aware of a history of racial oppression. Now, as far as the way that social scientists think about race nowadays, the American Association for the Advancement of Science has written that race has no biological justification. This goes way back. There was a German scientist named Johann Herder in 1785 that said that race was a useless category because colors bleed into each other. The American Anthropological Association has called for the elimination of racial categories by 2010. Well, I'm not necessarily endorsing that or saying that we're ready. I'm just trying to give you a sense of what debate is about. Yet a lot of us, even in the academic circles, go on acting as if the color of our skin or our phenotype, that's our outward experiences, appearances, influences the way that we interpret or the way that we participate in culture. So what I'm going to do tonight is let you hear from the figures in my book and let them voice their own critique of racialism and then to voice their alternative to that. Now, Marley viewed racialism as a sort of mental slavery, which we'll talk about in a moment. Douglas, if we could have him on the screen here, called racialism a diseased imagination. And he said that is this metaphor is a disease, that diseases have their periods of relative remission and their periods of contagion. And that if racism and racialism couldn't be cured, it could at least be contained, in his view, by presenting a more attractive alternative. So that's what Douglas was about, is balancing those two things, the critique of the thing that he was against and the articulation of an alternative. And that's also what I'll be involved in tonight. So this is very contested turf, as I'm sure all of you know. People get in very heated arguments about it. And I think that the debates, from my experience, about race nowadays has often been polarized in public sphere debate in a way in such that those who insist that racialism should be resisted without regard to color will be beat over the head with something called history and accused of being naive, if not reactionary. Now, this context, which I've been involved in over many, many years, has impressed upon me the importance of a truly historicized identity politics, the need to move beyond action-reaction cycles and towards a synthesis, towards a re-envisioning of his story as our story. So let me tell you just a little bit about my own story, which is where this starts and how I got into this. I was a journalist and a songwriter in Austin, Texas, during the 1980s. And I used to write journalism primarily about Afro-American and Latino forms of theater and music. So sometimes my audience would ask me, well, what gives you the right to criticize our culture? So this is part of the process that set me thinking about why was it that in some ways I thought of it as our culture? Was I a cultural imperialist? Or what was my place in this culture? The place was contested, so I had to think about it. At the same time, one of the reasons that I thought of it as our culture was I was a songwriter for a dance band, a funk and reggae band in Austin, Texas. And the band was really mixed. We had a lead singer who was Afro-American. We had a backup singer who was Filipina. Our bass player was from Argentina, a Latino. And we had a bass player who was a Jewish drummer from South Africa. So the audience looked pretty much like us. In other words, we were really mixed. But at the same time, we were playing styles of music that we're accustomed to think of as black. So this is just another example of some of what I've been going through in my life that made me think about what does it mean to place culture within a racial box. It forced me to ask myself, what does it mean to be a part of and to claim to speak to a multiracial community, or which I would say more accurately would be multi-ethnic or multicultural. So this is why I went into the process. One of the reasons I went into the process of writing this book is that I knew that in the process of being in this world and claiming to speak to it and with it, that I needed to be historically grounded. So I went searching for the roots of the cultures that I was engaged in as a songwriter and as a journalist, and as a human being. Let me just start you off with Douglas with a little story about what I am doing with him. I went to hear Bettina Apthicker the other night at Cody's, and she was talking about Angela Davis. And Angela, of course, got fired by the Regents of UCLA back in, I think it was 1969. And when she went back to teach that fall, after having been reinstated, she had 2,000 students show up for her first lecture. And guess what she was teaching about? This gentleman right here, Frederick Douglass. So I'd really love to know what Angela Davis was teaching about Frederick Douglass. Which Frederick Douglass did she focus on? And a part of whose history and whose culture? I give a lot of different voices. People still debate about Frederick Douglass to this day. Rappers quote him, Supreme Court justices quote him, political theorists quote him for various reasons, both with and against his legacy. He's still a contested figure. But I'm going to start you with a quote by a political theorist named Michael Lind, who wrote that Frederick Douglass was the greatest American in his view. And he argued that if we're going to have monuments to our slaveholding fathers in Washington, D.C., that Frederick Douglass ought to have a monument the same size as they did, that he was that important in our history. And I agree. I'll try to give you a very brief glimpse of that. This is a man who lived from 1818 to 1895. He's an escaped slave, an abolitionist orator, a journalist, a women's rights man, an advisor to presidents, a diplomat in the Caribbean. His life spans almost the entire 19th century. So what I want to do is start you with a clip that shows Frederick Douglass as a young man. This is him of about age 28, and issues of authenticity. And what's happened is that this is a man who never had one day of schooling in his life. Not a single one. Yet there's many people who believe he was the greatest orator of the 19th century. He went on to become what is the modern day equivalent of a pop star and a sex symbol. Aside from being, you know, a great speaker and an orator, he had a large impact on the popular culture of his day. So when this process started as a young man recently out of slavery, this caused problems with the notions of authenticity. And I find that this debate is still relevant today, i.e., what are our notions of authenticity, particularly with regard to regards to black culture. So I'm going to show you a video clip that has a recreation of Douglass speaking about this notion of authenticity. If we can cut the slide.
Let us have the facts, said the people. We will take care of the philosophy. Be yourself and tell your story. Better to have a little of the plantation manner of speech than not. 'Tis not best you seem too learned. I could not always obey, for I was now reading and thinking. It did not entirely satisfy me to narrate wrongs. I felt like denouncing them. I was growing and needed room.
So I have taught at Contra Costa College as well as, you know, elite universities like Cal, and I find that my students are still struggling with the same issue today. Douglass had a sponsorship, as it were, with William Lloyd Garrison, in a mainstream group of abolitionists who were mostly white, mostly of European descent. They wanted him to sound like an authentic black man. And he was a slave, an escaped slave. So what would an escaped slave sound like? You know, he spoke broken English, right? And they needed Douglass to be their figurehead to popularize the anti-slavery cause. And if it became felt that Douglass was not really a former slave, then that destroyed his credibility. So his authenticity as an anti-slavery spokesperson was really closely tied to his authenticity as a slave. And people had preconceived notions of what that culture sounded like. And Douglass said, I'm gonna be as eloquent as I can. I'm going to speak like an educated man. And that's what he did. He wasn't going to let anyone put racial boxes on him. So the thing that his advisors feared, in fact, happened, that nobody believed he had ever been a slave. And that's why he wrote his autobiography and had to escape to England. I'm going to give you just a really brief glimpse of how Douglass saw himself. Because when I am talking about people who speak to a mixed public and who view themselves as part of more than one public, then I don't want you to think that I'm making this up. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples. There's a picture in the book of Frederick Douglass, who's about a 60-year-old, when he had become a national icon. He's on the cover of Harper's Weekly here. And he's a political appointee of the Republicans. Hard to believe it now, but they were the anti-slavery group in Douglass's day. So people are coming to paint his picture, to sculpt him, and this kind of thing. And a man came to paint Frederick Douglass's picture and wanted to get the black side of Frederick Douglass, which a lot of people did. So Douglass always uses these encounters to challenge people's preconceptions. He gave a speech in which he described this encounter. He said, a painter was painting me today and insisted on showing my full face, for that is Ethiopian, which is what they called black people in those days. Douglass said, take my side face, for that is Caucasian, though should you try my quarter face, you would find it Indian. I don't know that any race can claim me, but being identified with slaves as I am, I think that I know the meaning of the inquiry. So I think you can hear the distinction between a public personality and a private identity, that publicly Douglass is a representative of and a freedom fighter for the rights primarily of black Americans. Privately, he sees himself as all the above. He used this oftentimes with humor. As I said, he challenged people's preconceptions wherever he went, and he used his own mixed background to do that. He was on a ferry once in 1848 on the way to an abolitionist convention in Cleveland, and he ran into a slaveholder. This is a passage that Douglass talks about in his autobiography, so this is where I'm quoting him from. And the slaveholder said that he didn't want to talk to a nigger. Douglass said, well, I'll tell you what, if it makes you feel any better, you can talk to the half of me that's white. So these are preconceptions that Douglass tried to deal with all the time. I'm going to have to be brief because I know our time is limited tonight. I had a clip that I was going to show you of Douglass in Great Britain, but I'm going to just tell you briefly that some of Douglass's greatest support networks were European, and this is a paradox I want to talk about briefly that we'll see later with Marley. Here's a freedom fighter in the cause of black liberation whose primary support networks are, quote, white people, people of European descent. So Douglass writes his autobiography. He goes to England. He becomes a very big celebrity there. His book is translated into German and Dutch and French. Lords and ladies are courting him. Poor people also come to see him. White women in particular really identify with Frederick Douglass. He's a women's rights man from day one. And they hear his discourse on freedom and identify with that. So a lot of the white feminists in Great Britain raise money for Douglass, and they buy his freedom, and they buy his printing press. So Douglass goes back to the U.S., sets up shop in Rochester, New York, and founds the North Star, which is generally thought of as the first black national newspaper in the U.S. Now, it just happens that 80% of his readers were people of European descent. The first reaction we might have was maybe they're the only ones that could afford it, but it's not actually that simple. William Lloyd Garrison had a paper called The Liberator. He was the first well-known abolitionist, and his readers were mostly black. In fact, he was underwritten by a black sailmaker in Philadelphia named James Fortin. So basically what we see here is some scholars have argued is two wings of the abolitionist movement, a black wing and a white wing, that overlap. And Douglass is at that overlapping place. And eventually over time, that side of overlapping becomes a movement in its own right. And Douglass becomes the voice of this multiracial abolitionism. I want to give you one more glimpse of where Douglass was coming from, and then move on. Douglass caused a lot of controversy later in his life because his first wife, with whom he had five children, died. He remarried a white woman, a feminist. One of Douglass's descendants said that this is all some of his people remembered about him, which raises the question of who Douglass thought his people were. As I argue at great length in the book, quoting Douglass at every turn, that he didn't see his people in racial terms. But as I said to begin the speech tonight, Douglass moved his critique to a larger level. He began fighting slavery and white supremacy, but he realized that the root of this problem was racialism, the confusion of people's appearance and their consciousness or their mentality or their intelligence or their culture. So he begins to fight racialism in all its forms. This includes a critique of people of all colors, which also caused a lot of controversy. Toward the end of his life, Douglass extended this critique in particular to many black Americans who Douglass felt were perpetuating the same racialism that he had criticized earlier in white people. So I'm going to give you a really brief example of that and give you an example of how these issues still live with us today. Douglass was giving a speech towards the end of his life and had this to say. about racialism among black Americans. He said, I see no benefit to be derived from this everlasting exhortation by speakers and writers among us to the cultivation of race pride. On the contrary, he said, I see it as a positive evil that is building on a false foundation. Besides, he asked, what is the thing that we are fighting against and what are we fighting for in this country? What is it but American race pride and assumption of superiority on the grounds of race and color? He also at one point said in response to his other Afro-Americans that when we isolate ourselves from people around us and say that we have nothing in common with you, well, the response will be in the same regards, for when the people care for nobody, nobody will care for them. So I gave this material to a speech to an Afro-American studies class at the University of North Carolina last fall. It's a large class. And at the end of the class, there was a young woman at the front, had funky dreads and kente cloth, raised her hand and quoted Sister Soldier to me. I don't know if any of y'all remember Sister Soldier. She was a controversy during the 1992 presidential campaign. I had her music actually before that, but the passage that the woman quoted to me was this. It's from a song of Sister Soldier, and it goes, if your great-great-grandfather raped my great-great-grandmother, and your great-grandfather robbed for my great-grandfather, and this goes through the generations, all right, up till today, then how in the hell do you expect me to trust you? Now, I think if I was a good white liberal, I probably would have shut up right then. I think that was the intended effect, was several. The woman was disappointed that Douglas did not identify himself as black. She was disappointed that he had criticized black people. And she was angry for me as being the messenger of this message. So how am I supposed to have a common ground with you under the terms of that history of rape and robbery and pillage and conquest? So I had to tell the woman that, you know, there's a piece of truth in what you say, but there's a whole lot of racial mythology. We project the racial mythologies of the present onto the past, and that colors what we say. The truth of the matter is that Frederick Douglass challenges those preconceptions in a whole lot of ways. He was a free black man from the North who spent his life speaking to the 90% of Euro-Americans that did not own slaves. Now, you can find these numbers in many records. 30% of the people of European descent lived in the South, and of those 30%, 30% owned slaves. Well, what did the other 90% think? You see? Some of them were active supporters of slavery. Some of them were active opponents of slavery. And a lot of them were on the fence somewhere. They had a range of attitudes, but they didn't all have a whip in their hand. And not all black people were being whipped. By the Civil War, I think it was around 25 to 30% were free in the North. So there's the history is not as easy as the racial mythology. And sometimes when the facts beneath the racial mythology are challenged, and that it makes us feel insecure. I know. Racial mythologies blind us in a lot of ways. KRS-One has a very different view of Frederick Douglass than the quote I read you earlier by Michael Lind, which is of Frederick Douglass as the greatest American. KRS-One is a rapper. He's over the hill now. But he gave an interview in Vibe magazine a couple of years ago in which he called Frederick Douglass a house nigger and a fucking sellout. So I talk about this in the book as another example of what racial mythologies are all about. I'm going to run out of my time for Marley, I know, but I feel like these issues are worth talking about, so I want to address this briefly. What's involved in that claim by KRS-One that he is willing to dismiss Frederick Douglass in those strong terms? I think that probably a lot of you know where that comes from. I mean, it comes from Malcolm, but it comes from a much deeper source than Malcolm, actually. But Malcolm, of course, had a typology of field niggers and house niggers. I will hope you realize that I don't use these terms in my life, but when I quote people, I'm not going to change their own language. So that's where I'm coming from. So in Malcolm's typologies, blacks are divided between two camps. They're either field niggers or house niggers. House niggers loved the white man. Field niggers hated the white man. House niggers sold out to the white man's oppressive system. Field niggers resisted that system by any means necessary. So in this us versus them binary racial mythology, one is not really black unless one is unalterably opposed to all things white. So this give me a little transition here, because KRS-One was actually at a reggae festival I went to this weekend in L.A. It's performing with Dancehall Stars, which is the contemporary reggae. And let me just sort of come at this issue about multiracial movements and authenticity and where do these things fit together through Marley in the time I have left. Marley is just blown up over the last couple of years. His legacy is continuing to get bigger and bigger. Bob said a thing back in 1975, which I find really amazing. He said, "My music will live forever." But I don't even think he had a clue over how true that was going to be. So we've had rap remakes of his album called Chantdown Babylon come out the last year. Time magazine named his album Exodus the album of the century. The British Broadcasting Corporation named his song One Love the song of the century. And this stuff just goes on and on. It's really an amazing phenomenon that Bob's legacy keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So I'm going to do something really similar with Bob Marley that I did with Frederick Douglass, and that's try to talk, let him say with his own words a little bit about how he saw himself and what he made of this multi-ethnic and multinational audience, which was his core group. So the context is that Marley's coming of age in the Caribbean in the 1960s when Jamaica is getting its independence. African countries are undergoing decolonization. So it's a militance in Marley's music. There's themes of, you know, Africa Unite, get up, stand up for your rights, slave driver, chase these crazy bald heads out of town, which is Bob is singing to all white audiences in Great Britain, if you can dig the irony. So people are picking up on this militance and the black unity themes, and they ask Bob, "Are you prejudiced against white people?" So this is where I'm going to start you with, is to play you Bob's response to this question.
"You don't have no prejudice about myself, because why me don't have no prejudice about myself? My father's a white and my mother black. No, them call me half caste or whatever. Well, me don't depend on nobody's side. Me don't depend on the black man's side nor the white man's side. Me depend on God's side, the man who created me, who caused me to become from black and white."
I have to translate this a lot of times when I teach it to my students, so I'll do that. Because I know that some of you won't understand it. Bob and the people in Jamaica speak in patois, or some of them say patois. And it's English. It's their own version of English. It's a really rich language. But anyway, what he says is essentially this, that I can't be prejudiced against myself. He says, "My father was white and my mother black, and them call me half caste or whatever." And then he says, "But I'm not on the black man's side or the white man's side. I'm on God's side, the one who created me, who caused me to come from black and white." So in the little time I have left, I kind of want to talk just a little bit about how Bob came to that self-concept and what Bob's sense of community was, what Bob actually meant when he said Rasta. I think that the awareness of Bob's life and culture beneath the millions who buy his records is probably pretty shallow. Let's see. Bob was referencing a history of race conflict in that quote. Now, if you study American history, you'll know of something very similar to what Bob's talking about when he says, "People call me a half-caste." And in American history, that's called tragic mulatto. And this notion that if you are of mixed, quote, race, of mixed heritage, then either society will destroy you or you will destroy yourself, right? You can find that in novels throughout history. And if you think it's still dead today, then go see Spike Movie's movie Jungle Fever. You'll see a really good example of the tragic mulatto still in action. So when Bob Marley was a youth, he got a lot of grief because most of what in Jamaica they call brown people had traditionally tried to associate themselves with the white upper class. Bob went against type. Bob grew up with the sufferers, the black sufferers, in the ghettos of Kingston. There's a lot of stories that people tell about him. He dated a young woman once in his Trenchtown yard, and the older brother of this woman cut off the relationship and said, "We don't want no white man messing up our bloodlines." So them style him a white man. This caused a lot of conflict. Rita Marley says that he was sometimes so confused about not knowing where he fit in this context that sometimes he would want to kill himself, i.e. he didn't have a father, he was of mixed race, he didn't know where he fit. So this is a central aspect of Bob Marley's life. And I argue a central reason why when he eventually gets to the place where he's quoting Haile Selassie's without regards to race philosophy, this rings particularly true, is especially relevant for Bob Marley, who's trying to find, to locate a philosophy in which he can combine these themes of black liberation, black independence, but also other aspects of his identity that can be connected to his increasingly multinational audience. Bob Marley's music is being sold to market Budweiser nowadays. So there's this question about, like, to what degree is Bob's music still revolutionary? So let me just give you a couple of angles on that. The really interesting thing with Bob is that he's really a very articulate man who is also very aware of context. So I'm going to start you with a clip of Bob in New Zealand claiming to be a revolutionary. And then I'm going to go to a clip of Bob at UCLA here in California giving a really different angle on what it means to be a revolutionary. So we start with Bob's claim to be a real revolutionary. This will be in New Zealand in 1979.
Revolutionaries, you know? You don't see myself as a revolutionary. Who don't have no help and not take no bribe from no one to fight it single-handed with music.
Okay. Now, after that, this is on his Survival tour. How many of y'all have the album Survival? What's on the cover? African flags, slave ships, right? This album was originally entitled Black Survival, and they changed it to Survival for marketing reasons. Bob went long on it. But there's absolutely no question about what the album is about, really, if you look at the cover and read the lyrics. So Bob didn't reach much of an Afro-American audience during his life. In fact, Afro-American DJs called his music jungle music. It wouldn't play it. But with Survival, he's beginning to reach to that demographic. He's playing the Apollo in New York and things like that. So what I'm going to show you now is a clip of Bob talking about what it means to be a revolutionary in a really different way. And this is to a group of Afro-American grad students and journalists at UCLA on the Survival Tour in 1979. This is a fairly long clip, but I think it's really important because it talks about the essence of where Bob is coming from in terms of, quote, racial identity and in terms of having a revolutionary consciousness. I need to set that up. There's a grad student at Cal, UCLA, in the Black Studies department who has asked Bob, how can you claim to be a revolutionary when you're a pop star and you're over here in the West? So what you're going to hear is Bob's answer to that question.
Are they doing anything towards revolution? Excuse me? Are they doing anything?
They're over here.
Towards revolution, I'm asking now.
They may have fight revolution, man. They may have revolutionaries. We don't even have to tell people that. You know, we don't want to tell no one that. You know what I mean? So we talk about African struggle. You see, you know Jamaica? You know how Jamaica and how black people reach Jamaica? You know how? The history of that? The history is through slavery. So when you're in Jamaica and you talk about Africa, when you're in the West and you speak of Africa, like maybe 7 years ago, mm-hmm. It was terrible. You know that? You know what I mean? You could even talk to you one black man about Africa and tell you you're not dealing with Africa.
Yeah.
Then I fight for Africa, man. You know, His Majesty, if it wasn't for Haile Selassie, there wouldn't be no Africa.
True.
It would have been Europe. Or I'm not changing names so much, you wouldn't have no Ethiopia. So I'm not talking about
revolution,
man. And I want to tell you, if the revolution must, if they want to win the revolution, they must win it with Rasta. Mm-hmm. It can't win no other way. Because if you win other way, you have to fight again. When you Rasta win, there's no more war.
Right, so, the end of all wars.
Cause of war, forget about that. The root of the problem. That's what I feel
like. If you study the lyrics to the song War, you see what His Majesty had to say about it. And if you can base your life on that philosophy, then you become a Rasta, you know?
Okay. That's Junior Marvin, who was the guitarist in Bob's band at the time. So, a couple of key themes here that I want to focus on. And one is this debate on, like, are we a revolutionary or not? And what does it mean to be a Rasta? Okay? That's the two things I want to talk to you about for a moment. Bob is saying that he's been going through this country and people here didn't even want to talk about Africa, but now times are changing. He says, I'm not even claiming to be a revolutionary. Because if you go and fight a revolution with guns, then when you get through, he says, you're going to have to fight the war all over again. But if you win the war with Rasta, then there'll be no more war. So what he's referencing here is he always does over and over again is Haile Selassie's 1963 speech to the United Nations, which is called What Life Has Taught Me on the Question of Racial Prejudice. That was put to music word by word in the song War, which many of you will have heard. And it says in brief, until the color of a man's eyes is no more significant than the color of his skin, vice versa. Until the color of a man's skin is no more important than the color of his eyes, that until equal rights are guaranteed to all without regard to race, that there will always be war. I think that we can look at history and see what Bob is talking about, that people who are a formerly oppressed group and fight a revolutionary war and come to power, when they get into power, what do? Well, of course, they turn around and they oppress someone else, and the cycle goes on and on and on. So what Bob is saying here is that we need a revolution in consciousness. And what he called that revolution in consciousness was Rasta. So at the end of the speech, you hear Junior Marvin, his guitarist, saying that if you were to put this teachings of without regards to race into practice, then you too can be a Rasta. So let me just sort of close here with a little bit of discussion about what Bob meant when he said Rasta, and what Bob made of the fact that a lot of his fans were Japanese and European and etc. So in the book, I talk about Rasta in these terms, that as Frederick Douglass once said, it is just as important to articulate what you stand for as it is what you stand against, okay? So the Rastas stood against Babylon. That's a metaphor. I'm going to read you a passage from the book. This is from an Afro-American scholar named Jack Johnson Hill, who went down to Jamaica and lived with the Rastas. And he defined their view of Babylon, the system to which they were opposed, in these terms. That it was an artificial, affluent society of self-absorbed individuals who worship idols and live decadent lifestyles at the expense of the poor. Does this sound familiar to any of y'all? He's not talking about us, I know. Worshipping idols and living decadent lifestyles. That's Babylon. So people ask, what do you mean by Babylon? Is that the white man's system? He said, no. It's much bigger than that. But what they stood for, I break down into three main things. One was a sustainable lifestyle. This is a very important part of what the Rastas are about. They're vegetarians, and they believe in trotting lightly on the earth, essentially. The second part was a post-white supremacy worldview. This is a movement that's emerging in opposition to white supremacy. Some of them then turn around and articulate a vision of black supremacy. But I think the essence of where most Rastas are coming from is to try to move beyond racialism altogether. And the third aspect is I consciousness, which simply means that you don't project deity out there, that you recognize that the spirit dwells within us. And that's a very old tradition, of course. You can read it in the Gnostics and many other places. So in closing, I want to just give you some glimpses of what happened when Bob took this message on the road and went to an international audience. People, of course, continued often to try to put racial categories on him. So Bob was in New York once, and he had this to say: "Don't talk to me about black and white. We fly a color which is red, gold, and green. We're not prejudiced. We leave judgment entirely into Jah." This is double voice music, like Bob always has. Red, gold, and green are the colors of African liberation, right? But at the same time, they are a banner for an international movement. As the guitarist Junior Marvin said here, if you can follow those teachings, or the three things I laid out here in my book, you too can be a Rasta. So red, gold, and green is the colors of African liberation, but it's also the colors of an international cultural movement. And Bob's saying our movement is about what those colors represent. It's not about black and white. Bob had to speak to many different parts of his audience. One part of that audience was a group of black nationalists, or what we sometimes today call Afrocentrists, which many Rastas are today. There's a group in Jamaica called the Bobos, which are black supremacists. And they have voices like Sizzla and Anthony B. But so Bob engaged these folks in debate too. And this is the way he voiced it to them. He said, "You must not bow to the white man. You must be superior to him. That means you cannot be prejudiced. Because if you are superior, then how can you be prejudiced?" So he's taken that thought process to its logical conclusion. He also is often asked about what he makes the fact that he's a, quote, a black man whose primarily followers are white. And this is, once again, the way that Bob tried to rearticulate this in a new way. Bob said, "It is God who make everybody, and him make a way for the black man that the white man have to follow. Because out of the black man come the white man, all men." I hope that you all can read women into this. You know, that's one of the problems that we have with the Rastas. None of our models are perfect. But what he's doing here is he's talking about Africa is the origin of all human beings, right? Which most scientists today will affirm that we came out of Africa. So if Africa was the mother of all races, and if the forerunners of the human race did indeed first appear in Ethiopia, then all races were related. Black and white people were cousins, and even Europeans were Ethiopians in an ancestral sense. Let me try to talk to you for a moment about Bob's legacy, and then we'll open this up to questions. There's a Jamaican anthropologist named Barry Chavanis who says that Bob Marley's decision, his process of going out touring globally, was the Rasta equivalent of Paul's decision to speak to the Gentiles. Now, can you follow me on that one? Now, when you're talking about Paul going to speak to the Gentiles, you're talking about what was once a Jewish religion, right? Being translated to a global audience, which they called Gentiles. Anything non-Jewish in those days was Gentiles. So this started much earlier when the Jews were carried away from Babylon. This song you'll hear in Rasta culture, as well as like Frederick Douglass's speech, "By the rivers of Babylon, there I sat down and wept." Well, when the Jews were carried away to Babylon, they had to begin the process of thinking. They're not there in Jerusalem where they can do their rituals anymore, and they have to think, is this a Jewish God? Or is it a house of prayer for all people? So when Paul goes and speaks to the Gentiles, then you can see that process of translation going on, that they're rearticulating a notion of a house of prayer for all people. When Bob Marley and the Rastas go international, they have to think about this same process, and they have to ask themselves, is this a black God? Or is this a God of all people that we're talking about? And it's a journey. It's not a complete journey. But the essence of the journey, in my view, really can be found in many reggae songs that talk about one blood. And that's a quote from Acts 17:26. says, of one blood, God has created all nations that dwell upon the face of the earth. So when you hear Bob Marley's most famous song, One Love, then that's what he's talking about, one love, one heart. Y'all remember the lines of the song? Is there a place for the hopeless sinner who has hurt all mankind just to save his own? So the answer is in the chorus. It depends on how you want to interpret the chorus. I'm not going to tell you what I think the right interpretation is, because Bob's music speaks in many different ways to many different people. Neville Garrick was a Jamaican art designer who studied under Angela Davis at UCLA and then went on to do lights for Bob, has described Bob's music as new psalms, which I find really evocative, maybe because I grew up in the church, you know. I only actually started looking up my Bible again because I went to Jamaica and heard the Rastas quoting it, okay? And it made me look at my own roots in a new way. But psalms are things that you quote at every opportunity. You put them to music. You recycle them, right? So this is exactly what we see with Bob Marley's music today, is that if you think about his lyrics in those terms, why they have had such an amazing musical afterlife, they're like psalms. They're like lyrics that are quoted often by the faithful. We're about out of time here, so I want to just give you one sense of what I mean by talking about Douglas and Marley as integrative ancestors. This is one of the main themes of the book. In the beginning of the book, I say, if iconic figures such as Douglas, Ellison, and Marley were presented in our school books and in the popular imagination as integrative ancestors who could be claimed by more than one ethno-racial group, well, would this help us to build a democracy in which commonality and difference could coexist? This is coming out of my experience of having these people put in racial boxes. So what I did when Selah, my little youth over here, Selah, get us a veneer key. This is Selah. I wrote this book for her. I dedicated it to her. When she was a little bitty youth, we used to go dance to Bob Marley tunes. Espera un momentito, Selah. And I had life-size pictures of Frederick Douglass and Bob Marley on the walls, because I wanted Selah to grow up surrounded by images of people who look like her, and images of people in which she could see that both her mom and her dad had a heritage. So we'd go in and say goodnight to them at night, and she'd say, Buenas noches, abuelo Frederick. Good night, granddad Frederick. And buenas noches, tío Bob. So she started eventually getting a real interest in slavery. I discuss this in the book. But anyway, she started making up stories about Frederick Douglass and Bob Marley. So eventually she started asking me, Dad, is this a story I made up in this book here? She thought it came from somewhere else. And then she wanted to know, Dad, are you going to put my story in your book? And I said, well, yes, Selah, I will. Because I thought it actually illustrates what I'm talking about when I say what an integrative ancestor is. So, Selah, ¿quieres hablar primero en español o después en inglés?
Inglés first.
So, inglés esta vez? Okay.
No, English.
Okay. So, tell them your story, Selah.
This
one. No, déjalo aquí. Déjalo aquí. Okay, habla.
You can tell me which one you want first, the English or Spanish?
Español primero.
Español? Okay. Mejor inglés. Better English, but.
Okay, ándale.
Once upon a time.
No, once upon a time.
Once upon a time, Bob Marley and Frederick Douglass were walking in the road, but Frederick Douglass turned into a star and Bob Marley turned into a lion. A ghost attacked, but Bob Marley saved them and they keep walking.
Okay, gracias.
Okay. Había una vez.
Oh, en español, okay.
Bob Marley y Frederick Douglass están caminando. But Marley didn't call the children yesterday, yeah. And Frederick Douglass and Leon and Fantasma Taco Pell, but Marley no sabo.
Gracias.
Oh. El fin.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not sure where all that came about. Whoops, I'm sorry. I'll talk about this in the book. But anyway, that's the notion that these folks are rooted in a history, but they are speaking to audiences of the future. And we don't know how audiences of the future are going to interpret their message. And that's kind of what I'm getting at with Selah's story, or that Frederick Douglass and Bob Marley are walking down the road, and Frederick Douglass converts into a star. That's the North Star, right? Bob Marley converts into a lion. Well, the lion is the Lion of Judah. That's the Rasta's icon. So we don't know how audience of the future, what they will make of this legacy. So out of the mouth of babes, right, come some amazing things. I want to just think for just a moment about moving towards the future and what it takes to create community and citizenship in which our commonalities and difference can coexist. I have a quote from Noam Chomsky that I always really liked. And Noam Chomsky says that social action must be animated by a vision of a future society. Social action must be animated by a vision of a future society. As we are engaging in social action, do we have a vision of a future that animates the way that we think and talk and act? And I wrote an LA Times piece about Marley a couple of weeks ago in which I said that I think this is what I get out of this legacy of Douglass and of Marley, that the exodus away from racialism that Marley advocated does not mean to forget the history of racial oppression. It means to avoid repeating the pattern. And to avoid repeating the pattern of racialism requires a new language and a new consciousness, as I say in my book, A New Culture. That doesn't mean that it's going to be a utopian process. That doesn't mean we're all going to magically get along all of a sudden. It's not going to work that way. Ralph Ellison talked about the historical process of interaction between black and white people in this country is a form of antagonistic cooperation, which I found really evocative, that it's not been all good and it's not been all bad. There's been a lot of conflict. But if you think of this metaphor of antagonistic cooperation, whether you focus on the antagonism or on the cooperation, the end result is still co-creation, for which all of us can claim responsibility. For which all of us must claim responsibility. I appreciate your time, and I'm going to open the floor for you all now. Thank you very much. If anybody has comments or questions, I'm supposed to ask you to wait until a microphone comes your way. Yes, sir.
I have a number of different comments to make, but also in the context of a critical interrogation of some of what you've raised here. I think it's clear, first of all, with any commonsensical understanding of American history over the past 2 to 3 centuries, that Americans, generally speaking, share a quote-unquote common heritage. With that understanding, however, there is a larger and a broader context that needs to be addressed seriously without egregiously engaging in what I call backdoor reductionism. For example, it's clear to me that it's reductive to claim that people who are concerned about the relationship between race as a social construct and racism as an ideological and political, economic, and cultural form of oppression and exploitation are people who are interested in a very complex, very conflicted understanding of American history. In other words, the individual from University of North Carolina who raised, I think, an important question, whether we agree with the context of the question or not, or whether we even agree with what we perceive, rightly or wrongly, as the implications of the question, needs to be addressed in a serious way, because while race, of course, is a myth, racism isn't. And because of the prevalence and the predominance of racial thinking in the United States from the standpoint of ideology and political and economic systems, it's important, and I think all three of these individuals represent that understanding, that complex, conflicted understanding that is not reductive, that while on the one hand, we have to address the question of the manipulative aspects of race as a social construct, we also, at the same time, have to deal with the implications of dealing with racism as a incredibly destructive notion of what American citizenship is. So that when we look at metaphor in terms of language, Malcolm X was speaking in metaphorical terms, highly symbolic terms, with an incredibly complex understanding of American history when he raised the question of house niggers and field niggers. He wasn't merely engaging in binary philosophizing, shall we say, when he raised those particular categories. It's necessary for us to deal with the fact that when people speak in metaphorical terms, that they are trying to include a much broader context for our understanding of what reality is than that which we have been all taught. So therefore, I don't see any conflict whatsoever when we start talking about American citizenship, but there is a highly contested, highly conflicted, highly complex war that persists when we start talking about it in terms of racism, which is a force that is much more concrete, much more real, and has much more serious repercussions for all of us than a mere academic discussion of race as a social construct. Now, it's almost impossible for me in this very limited time to go into all the ramifications of that. But just from the standpoint of logic, it seems to me that it's important not to engage in an egregious reductionism when we begin to deal with the question of race as social construct vis-a-vis racism as an ideological and political, economic, cultural force. And until we do that in some, in my view, much more sophisticated and much more complex terms, we're not going to seriously address the question of identity, quote unquote, and we're certainly not going to deal in a serious way with the question of how do we, quote unquote, resolve these kinds of issues while this political and economic system as presently constituted and as historically constituted is still intact. And until we can look at the relationship between individual transformation and social transformation as coexisting, then we're not going to seriously address the question of commonality and difference, because those remain abstractions, and Manichaean abstractions, binary oppositions, as long as we don't deal with the fact that, as the late C.L.R. James put it, one cannot merely change in one's head that which can only be changed in society. My second and last point, and then I'll shut up, is a question, because there's a lot to deal with here, and it's impossible to deal with it in any kind of a realistic way without bringing in all of this stuff, so bear with me. The last part of it is, the overwhelming majority of African Americans historically are for and are fierce advocates of multiracialism. That goes for everybody from Ida B. Wells, Pauline Hopkins, William Monroe Trotter, not to mention W.B. Du Bois, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, Amiri Baraka, Ishmael Reed, Toni Morrison, on and on and on and on. That's not the problem. The problem is there is fierce, structural, systemic, institutional opposition to African Americans advocating multiracialism in the United States. And we all know that old story. I don't have to go over that again. But we can't merely address that in purely abstract, academic, intellectual terms. That has to be dealt with at the level of society and economy and all of that. But it's highly offensive to me for someone to suggest at this late date that African Americans in general do not support the kinds of positions advocated by Frederick Douglass, Bob Marley, and Ralph Ellison. In point of fact, the major figures in American history over the past 250 to 300 years have all been, quote unquote, African Americans, from A. Philip Randolph to all of Frederick Douglass' contemporaries. We can talk about Sojourner Truth, we can talk about Harriet Tubman, we can talk about Pauline Hopkins, we can talk about Francis Harper, right? We can talk about all of the people who are affiliated with A. Philip Randolph and Dr. Martin Luther King and Paul Robeson in this century. Unfortunately, however, every single one of those individuals, as we well know, have been lynched, assassinated, attacked, misrepresented, ridiculed, beaten, burned, tarred and feathered. That, too, is American history, and that, too, has to be accounted for. We can't merely discuss it in purely abstract terms and then try to divorce our understanding of that history with relationship to what you so eloquently have said here today. And so it seems to me that we need to take seriously that much larger, broader, and yes, multiracial, multinational, and global perspective, because if we don't, we will wind up trying to change in our heads that which can only be changed in society.
Yeah, I'll respond really briefly. On the first of what I hear is two main points, I don't really have any disagreement with you, and if you were to read my book, you'd see that. The term that people use nowadays to talk about systemic inequalities, the term that is used to deal with the fact that, yes, race is a fiction, but racism is not, is racial formations. And that's the notion that we are racialized and that racialized attitudes are perpetuated through our institutions, through economic systems, through a wide variety of notions. So I talk about this at great length in the book, and that's a core part of what I'm doing, is dealing with the reality of racial formations. At the same time, I say if we want to talk about the historical reality and the continuing endurance of racial formations, let's talk about multiracial formations. I don't think one needs to be done to the exclusion of the other. I balance those two essentially in the book. I do think that racial mythologies have blinded us to what Ralph Ellison called the true interrelatedness of blackness and whiteness. Now, as to why these institutional sanctions of racial formations are so pervasive, I'd have to disagree with you and leave it at that, that we can agree to disagree. In fact, there's been a movement during the 1990s for a multicultural, multi-ethnic, or multiracial category, and the fiercest opposition to that has come from Afro-Americans. That's a really huge phenomenon that I deal with as I can in the book, but it's, as you said, another book.
That is fundamentally.
Well, we all just have to disagree.
The last statement you made is untrue empirically, objectively speaking.
Well, you can. I'm sure there's
the
okay.
That is clearly wrong.
All right. Well, we disagree on that one. There's documentation probably for both of our views. We had a question right over here.
I don't think I need the microphone. We're taping this for. Well, I don't want to say what I was going to say. No, I just was going to make a comment that I think what the whole subject deals with is that the truth and justice is not in any of the categories. Truth and justice is where we find it. You know, truth and justice is just out there. And when I talk about, you know, like gay or straight or male or female, masculinity, feminism, we find people thinking that the truth is, you know, like a gay male might think, okay, my truth is the only truth, and I will trust another gay male just because he's gay. Or a woman will say, well, I'll trust that woman because she's a woman. And the truth is just somewhere else. The truth is in our hearts. And our truth and our justice is to be found where it is, not in the categories, not in the colors, not in what cars we drive, not in the clothes we wear. That's all the comment I wanted to make.
Well, the main point I really try to make with my book is that truth and rights is a culture and a movement that's multiracial, multigendered, and I draw inspiration from that. So if we want to think about how do we change these racial formations or other patterns of exclusion, I believe it requires coalitions. And to build a coalition, one needs language, one needs new consciousness. Yes. Wait till the mic gets there.
Okay, the question that I have is that in Frederick Douglass's book, he mentions an Austin Gore. And if you trace his lineage to this day, to this present day in our new culture, he has a relationship with our Vice President Gore. Okay. So am I led to believe that this is still not a democracy, but it is a handed down government from one family, and that there are no racial motivations? Just like when I was growing up, I would go to my grandmother's house for Sunday dinner, and then I'd come back here and go to my friend's house for Sunday dinner, it'd be completely different. So are we brought up to live, to believe like they believe, and they're the way that one house is run, governing a whole place, if that makes sense? And another comment another question that I have is, how do you communicate that to somebody? How would you sit there and say, it has nothing to do with race, it has to do with fraud? Basically, you know, school books teach us that this is a democracy and that we all have the right to vote on something or another.
I talk about that at great length. I analyze a speech of Frederick Douglass's called What to the Slave is the 4th of July. Frederick Douglass got in front of a group of people in Rochester, New York, and said, what to the slave is the 4th of July? In other words, he's criticizing the hypocrisy of a slaveholding republic holding celebrations of freedom. So I feel this is getting to your question. What he does after the first half of his speech of... He calls America the most hypocritical nation in the world. But then he looks for a new foundation on which to build, and he's unwilling to throw out the baby with the bathwater. So he says, one blood, strictly one blood I deal with, as the Rastas would say. He quotes this passage about one blood. Where does the new consciousness come from that's capable of going beyond the hypocrisy? That's one side. He believes in one blood. The other side is... He says, we are the true revolutionaries. I believe in those ideals the Founding Fathers said. This is what Douglass says. Yeah, they were hypocrites, but do you have a better ideal? He said, we, the abolitionists, are the true revolutionaries because we're putting those ideals into practice. So everybody has to find their own answer for that. That's what I found in the book, is that the ideals are not bad, it's the enactment. And if you have a better ideal than one blood and equal rights, then I'd like to hear it. I know we're short on time, so let's go to like one or two more questions, if anybody has some.
How are we doing on time? Okay. Thank you very much, Gregory, and you'll have a little time to talk with him afterwards outside in the lobby. I don't know what his schedule is, but his book is available here through the library. And thank you all for coming.
And showers of blessings on everybody.